still at the mention of his name. They'll say my God is still the same as the wolves. If we still fall at the mighty sound of praise, they'll say my God is still the same. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. When did he lose his power? When did his mercy change? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. They'll say my God is still the same. Just ask the grave if it's strong enough to keep open its chains. It'll say God is still the same. Yeah. When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. Never has, never will. My God is still the same. Yeah. Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once has he ever let go. Not once did he ever stop proving our God is in control. Not once did he ever stop moving. Not once did he ever let go. Ever stop proving our God is in control? When did he break his promise? When did his kindness fail? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. When did he lose his power? When did his mercy change? Never has, never will. My God is still the same. Not once did he ever stop moving. Did he ever stop moving? Not once did he ever let go. Never has, never will. My God is still the same. My God is still the same. My God is still the same. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father God, for your assurance today. Always the same. Always with us. Amen. Same yesterday, today, and forever. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Yes, indeed. It's wonderful to see you guys today on this beautiful weekend. Hallelujah. Has he been good to you this week? Hallelujah. If he's been great to you, then let's stand and sing our love unto him this morning, for he is worthy. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All I see is the battle. You see my victory. When all I see is the mountain, you see the mountain move. And as I walk through the shadows, your love surrounds me. There's nothing to fear now, for I'm safe with you. So when I fight, I'll fight on my knees, with my head lifted high. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. Every fear I lay at your feet, I'll sing through the night. Oh God, the battle belongs to you. And if you are for me, who can be against me?
Hallelujah.
Oh, yeah. For Jesus, there's nothing impossible for you. When all I see are the ashes, you see the beauty. Thank you, God. When all I see is the cross, God, you see the empty tomb. Any stronghold the enemy has formed in your life, we lay them down today. Amen. Can you say good riddance addiction? Can you say good riddance to bad relationships, poor decisions? Amen. God is with you this day. Amen. And I pray you're living a great life today, but your best is yet to come. Amen. We surrender ourselves unto Him and watch Him prosper us. Amen. His plan is to prosper. Amen. For hope, not harm. Amen. Yes. Hallelujah. Stand on His promises this day. Thank you, Lord.
Amen. You may be seated for just a brief moment. We have a few announcements to share with you, so we want to get to those. But first, we'd like to welcome you today. We are so glad to see all your faces here in the building this morning. We're also glad that for those of you who are joining us online, live, or if you are joining us at a later time on the rebroadcast, we're glad that you chose to worship with us today. We just want to remind you, if you are a first-time guest with us today, if you didn't receive a paper welcome pack from one of our greeters, you can scan the QR code, and we have a paperless version there. Also, we have our giving online. We have paperless ways to give, contactless ways to give. You can go to our website. You can scan the QR code, or we have areas in the back of the sanctuary and out in the lobby where you can give also. And just a reminder that at the conclusion of worship, our kids are dismissed to their classes with Pastor Brenda. So on to a couple other announcements. We want to make sure that you know what is happening in the neighborhood and here at Springfield Assembly. So make sure that you have got a copy of this month's happenings. It is has the yellow on it, so make sure that you have that so you will know what is coming up, times for different events that you may wish to attend. We also have coming up this Friday. Are you hungry? Nobody up. I hear a couple behind me that are all about it. Coming up this Friday is our next pasta dinner. We can use your assistance with desserts, pre-sales. If you are interested in signing up to get a pan of lasagna or just a portion of one, we've got these available out in the lobby. Or if you wanted to take orders for us, you can take one of those sheets as well and sign people up and get them well fed. We want to take just a minute. Melanie Meck wants to talk to us about our local Relay for Life, so let's give her a hand as she's coming up.
Thank you. Good morning. As most of you know, Springfield Assembly has a Relay for Life team that's participating this year, and I just wanted to give one more blurb on that and some things pertaining to that. So how many of you here today, if you are willing, if you are a cancer survivor, would you please stand with me? I know there's some of us here. And Lisa shared with us your good report from Morgantown, Mr. Jim. So he is cancer-free. Praise God. And then how many of you are caregivers? You've been a caregiver for someone who's fought the battle with cancer. You know, that's a lot of people, too. Yes. Thank you, because us survivors couldn't make it without you. Is there anybody that knows a family member or a friend that has gone through the cancer battle? Almost everybody in the sanctuary, I'm sure. So this is a cause that's near and dear to my heart, and this is my caregiver. I couldn't have made it without him. And he did research for me a couple years back, you know, because when we give to a charitable organization, we want to make sure that that money is used the way we want it to be used. And the American Cancer Society had one of the highest percentages that he could find anywhere, and it was up in the 90s, which is unheard of. Most of them were, you know, 50% or less that, you know, went directly back to what they said they were collecting money for. But as a cancer survivor, myself, I found the American Cancer Society website, which was cancer.org, to be invaluable to me. With all the information that it had for me, helping me to figure out what was coming my way with treatments and things and how to handle those, and then even life after cancer. But there's so many programs, there's not enough time for me to mention all of them today. But I'm just saying, if you know somebody or you yourself ever get that awful diagnosis, go to cancer.org, the American Cancer Society's website, and there's so much information and help there. One of the things that I used when I was 23 and had my first round of cancer was we stayed at Hope Lodge in Baltimore. And it was like staying in a hotel, but they only charged me $10 a night. You know, because we were newlyweds. We couldn't afford a $90 a night hotel. But they also, with a breast cancer, they have help for women with mastectomies and reconstruction and wigs and the Feel Better, Be Better makeup program. There's just a plethora of stuff that they have available to you if you need it. So, those of you that are survivors, if you would, please register with our Hampshire County Relay for Life. You don't have to come and participate in the walk if you don't want to, but every survivor gets a free t-shirt, a free purple, signifying that you are a survivor. And these papers are out on the table, welcome desk, and they have directions that you can use if you want to sign in online. They also have a phone number if you don't have internet access or an email. This is the same information that you would use if you just want to participate in Relay for Life. Right now, I think we have 7 or 8 members on our team, and if you want to join our team, we would love to have you. We have a good time. Let's see. Other ways that you can help, if you didn't want to participate necessarily, but you wanted to help monetarily, you could give a donation to any of the members on our team, and all of that money goes to the American Cancer Society. Right now, today, our team members are Alan and I, Pastor Melissa, Connie, Jody Ansel, Linda Carter, Chris and Larry Shook, and I've had a couple more, and Mary Reeder, and I've had a couple more that have mentioned to me that they want to join our team. So anybody and everybody's welcome. Again, those papers are on the welcome desk. Another way you can help if you want, we're selling tickets for an oil painting, and but it's a Civil War painting. It's Stonewall's Return, and it's by John Paul Strand, and it was donated by the Art Gallery in Antietam. If anybody's interested, those tickets are $5 each, or 5 tickets for $20. And also we have the Luminaria. And for anybody that's ever been to Relay, the Luminaria is a phenomenal and very moving part of our program. At the end of the evening, when it's getting dusky, we light all the Luminaria. And in the past, we've had it at the high school, so we spelled out the word hope with the bags and then lit them, and it was just really moving. This year, because of matters out of our own control, Relay is being held on the field behind the Caton Bridge Fire Department this year. Next year, we're looking at doing it at the fairgrounds, so it's more centrally located again. We're not able to use the high school anymore. But the Luminaria, they're $5 a piece if you buy them from one of our team members. And on the bag, we will write whatever message you want. It could be in memory of someone. It could be in honor of someone. You could give a special message, whatever you wish. And all 100% of that $5 goes to our team and Relay to help others. Let's see. Oh, these are the posters. There's like 3 or 4 out there. If you have a business or something and you would want to post this to advertise for us, that would be great. But you don't have to. I'm just offering. This year's Relay, how many of you knew Susan Grady? A lot of us did. Susan lost her fight this year. She had breast cancer years and years ago and beat it. And then this year it came back. And unfortunately, it was very, very aggressive and she lost her battle. Susan was actually the one that started Relay for Life here in Hampshire County. And then her and her sister Patty did it together forever. And now Patty and her daughter are continuing to lead our county. So this year's Relay is in honor and memory of Susan. But our very own praise band is one of the lineup shows for Relay for Life this year. So I'm so excited that they're going to be there and we're going to have a Christian presence at Relay. Last thing, I have about 4 of these. These are West Virginia Cancer Resources for a patient. So if anybody needs a copy of these, there's 3 or 4 of them out there on the table. And it just tells you all the places available for help here in West Virginia. And lastly, I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you to Pastor and the Deacon Board and the Relay members and the Praise Band. This is our best year yet. And so far, as of last night, we have raised together $2,940 for this great cause. So I'm so excited. And oh, thank you, Stephen. That's the painting, a bigger picture of the painting. And also, before that, he had up the picture. Friday night, we had our paint night, and it was so much fun. We had 21 people there, and Cindy told me when I first told her about it, she says, oh, I can't paint. And I said, Cindy, you got to come. It's really easy. The lady, she tells you exactly what to do, and you do it, and you think you can't paint, and when the night's over, you're like, wow, I did that. And she told me a couple different times she was really anxious about it. So Friday, she was having a really great time. And I went over to her and I said, aren't you glad you came? And she said, yes, I am. And she said, you know, I was this close to calling you earlier today and canceling. But I knew that would hurt you. And I knew that Jess and Amelia would never forgive me. So I came. And she said, I'm so glad I did. And then yesterday, she messaged me and she says, I want to schedule a paint night for ladies' night for WMs. So, and I've had several people also say, I hope you'll do it again because I wasn't able to come then, but I really want to come. So yes, we are going to do it again. So thank you, everybody. We could not do any of this without you all. Thank you. I'm so thankful for my church.
Amen. It was a good evening. Just a couple of couple more things real quick. Just a reminder, we put the info out there last week that if you would like to donate to help our kids go to summer camp this year, and we also have opportunity for them to go to Love in Action later on this summer, which is a missions focus for them. You can put that in an envelope and mark that Kids for Christ, KFC Camp, or Mission Youth Missions, and that money will go in its entirety to our kids and to our youth. Investing in our kids, investing in our youth is one of the best investments we can make. Amen? Amen. So let the Lord speak to your heart about what he wants you to do and how you can get involved in that. And just a quick reminder that next Sunday is going to be our grad Sunday. So if you have a grad and haven't contacted the office yet, please do so by Tuesday of this week. And then also on the 19th, anybody know what day that is? Father's Day, yes it is. So we want to encourage you to bring your father, to bring any guys who are in your life, because we're just going to have a special and a fun day. We're going to do kind of a cookout barbecue theme, so you can come dressed casually, not too casually, but casual barbecue dress, and just come and have a good time and celebrate with us on that special day. So if you would all stand right now, we're going to go before the Lord in prayer before we go back into worship. We know that there are many needs within our community, needs within our church family. We also have a special need that we would like for you to keep in mind. Pastor Rick talked with Bunny last night, and Dr. Tom is having some serious health challenges, and they just really desire all of our prayers for Dr. Tom and also for Bunny too, because as many of you know, it's a very involved thing to be giving that care around the clock, and God bless her and God bless him both. So if you have a need this morning, while we pray, just lift that need up to the Lord. If it's a certain person that's on your mind, call their name out to the Lord. He already knows what's on our hearts and in our minds and the things that are heavy on us. And he is the one who will help us. He strengthens us and he makes the way. He's our healer. He's provision. He is everything we need. So let's go to the Lord this morning. Father, we are so grateful to you for sending your son Jesus, for all that Jesus bore for us, for the stripes that he suffered for our healing, for dying on the cross for forgiveness of our sin, that we may have eternal life with you. Lord, and you know the needs that have been brought into this house today. Lord, you know the ones whose hearts are heavy, Lord Jesus, just knowing the need and the things that need a mighty touch of you, that need your intervention in their life. And Father, we bring these needs to you this morning because we know, because we have seen what you have done in the past, Lord Jesus. That has built our faith as we have seen you step in and change situations, as we have seen you step in and change people and hardened hearts, Lord Jesus. Father, we know that you are faithful. We know that you are working all things together for good to those who are the called, Lord, according to you, and those who love you, Lord Jesus. And Father, we lift each and every need to you this morning, Lord, in faith, believing that you have heard our heart's cry, Lord Jesus, Lord, and that you are already working behind the scenes, Lord Jesus. God, we never want to fail to give you praise. We never want to fail to place our trust in you, God, because everything we have and all that we are is because of you, Lord. And God, we ask you that as we continue throughout this service today, Lord, that you would be blessed, that you would be glorified, and that you would be honored today, Lord Jesus. And we thank you, God, for all that you have done for us and all that you are going to do. And we ask it all in the precious and holy name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's worship together.
fullness of eternal promise, stirring in your sons and daughters, earth revealing heaven's wonders.
Spirit come, Spirit come.
And what you spoke is now unfolding, and all your children shall behold it. Dreams awaken in this moment.
Spirit come, Spirit come. Pour it out, let your love run over here and now. Let your glory fill this house, pour it out. Let your love run over here and now. Let your glory fill this house.
Now the world awaits your presence, and this power is within us. We will rise to be your witness.
Spirit come, Spirit come. Pour it out, let your love run over here and now. Let your glory fill its house, pour it out. Let your love run over here and now. Let your glory fill its house.
Tongues of fire testifying of the Son's one desire.
Spirit come, Spirit come,
speak revival, prophesy like it is done.
One desire.
Spirit come, Spirit come, tongues of fire testifying of the someone desire.
Spirit come, Spirit come,
speak revival, prophesy like it is done. One desire.
Spirit come, Spirit come,
Spirit come. Let our hearts continue burning, for our King is soon returning. As we hold to this assurance,
Spirit come, Spirit come, Spirit come, Spirit come.
Pour it out, let your love run over here and now. Let your glory fill this house. Pour it out, let your love run over here and now. Let your glory fill this house. Let your love run over here and now. Let your glory fill this house. Pour it out. Let your love run over
Let your glory fill this house. Tongues of fire testifying of the someone desire.
Spirit come, Spirit come,
speak revival. Prophesy like it is the one desire.
Spirit come, Spirit come,
Spirit come.
Thank you, Father God, for the fire in us, Jesus. Stir, we ask of thee, Holy Spirit, today. Lord God, strike that match, that spark, Father God, that, Father, we would run, Father God, for you, Lord Jesus. That, Father God, each day we would be that reflection of who you are, Lord God. Loving, Lord God, all people, Lord Jesus. Sharing you, the wonderful you, your wonderful love. Father God, stir within us, Lord Jesus, this passion, compassion, Father God, for others today, Lord God. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Holy Spirit, we thank you for your sweet presence today. Fill our hearts, Lord. Fill our hearts today, Jesus. Glory to you, Father. Glory.
Alone in my sorrow and dead in my sin, lost without hope with no place to begin. Your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, ash was redeemed, only beauty remained. My orphan heart was given the name. My morning grew quiet, my feet rose to dance. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over. Chains, I'm a prisoner no more. My shame was a ransom he faithfully bore. He canceled my debt and he called me his friend. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, your grace, so free, washes over. Made me new, now life begins.
Darkness rejoiced as though heaven had lost. But then Jesus arose with our freedom in hand. That's when death was arrested and my life began. In him. Hallelujah. You are a new creature this day, church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He paid it all. Paid it all. Thank you, Jesus. And you chose us and call us each by name today. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God. Hallelujah. You
seems to be your way. We trust in you, God, you have the final say. You are the way when there seems to be no way. We trust in you, God, you have the final say. You are the way when there seems to be no way. We trust in you, God, you have. We'll see a miracle. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. Move the unmovable. Break the unbreakable. God, we believe. God, we believe for it. From the impossible.
Hallelujah. 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 What are you believing God for today? What do you need God to do in your life today? Some of you need a healing touch in your body. Some of you had needs for friends or family that need a healing touch. Some of you need relationships restored. Some of you need direction. Not for sure what the next step holds. We're going to take it from that bridge again. You said it, I believe. That part. As we sing it, I want you to sing it like you believe. That no matter what you're facing this morning, no matter how deep the valley, no matter how dark the night, no matter how tall the mountain, God is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we can ask or even imagine. There is nothing that is too impossible. There's nothing that is too impossible. You're not on the path alone. You're not walking this by yourself. God is with you. I know there are times when we don't feel like it. And we've talked about that before. But the Word of God says that we walk by faith and not by sight. We don't always see what we want to see, but our faith tells us that God is still there, that God is still on the throne, and that even though the night is dark, there's a new day coming. Even though the mountain is high, we're going to make it to the other side. Even though the valley is deep and lonely, you and I are not alone, for He is with us. Josh, sing one more time.
You said, I believe. You said, it is done. You said,
in the name that is higher than all names, in the name at which every knee will bow and every tongue confess, in the name of Jesus, in the name of Jesus, God, we speak healing in this place today. We speak healing. Lord, we speak physical healing. Lord, I know that in this place today, we've already heard, Lord, we've already seen the testimonies of cancer that has been overcome. And Lord, I pray, Lord, for bodies that need a physical touch today, whether in this building, Lord, whether watching live or recorded, Father, I pray that even now that your power would flow in the name of Jesus. That healing would take place in the name of Jesus. God, I pray for emotional healing today, Lord. For those, Lord, who are walking that path, Lord, where they seem to be alone, where oppression and depression are sinking in. Father, I pray that you would come and break the unbreakable in Jesus' name. Lord, for those mountains that seem, Lord, that there's no way over or around, God, move the unmovable. In Jesus' name, in Jesus' name. God, for relationships, Lord, that are strained to the breaking point, and those, Lord, who may already be fractured, Father, I pray, God, that you would, Lord. God, as you brought the prodigal son home, once again, restore what the enemy has stolen. And God, speak new life and breathe new life into those relationships. God, I pray for the prodigal sons and daughters and grandchildren and great-grandchildren, Lord. Today, Father, I pray, Father, that, Lord, that word of God that's on the inside that may be covered over, Lord, by the things and the cares of life, God, and decisions that have been made. Father, I pray, Lord, we call forth that word in the name of Jesus. May it take root in their life even now. Father, I pray that you would send people into their lives to speak life. And breathe upon that word. Breathe upon that word. Father, may the songs, Lord, of VBS, may the songs of kids ministry, and may the songs of youth, Lord, may they flood their memories. May they be reminded of the grace in the Father's house. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father, I pray, Lord, as your word is about to be declared in this place, Father, I pray that Holy Spirit would touch our ears to hear it, touch our minds to understand it, and touch our hearts to receive it. In the mighty name of our Lord and Savior, we pray. Amen. Amen. Put your hands together. Give God praise in the house this morning. Oh, give me water. Oh, you can be seated. Go ahead and grab your cup and prepare it. Go ahead and get things ready. We're going to go to the Lord's table. We just sang, move the unmovable, right? Break the unbreakable. There's more than just words there. Or maybe I need to say that again. There's more than just words there. Move the unmovable. You know, there was a time in your life and my life when it seemed like there was an unmovable object. That sin that weighed us down. It was unmovable for your power and for my power. We had no authority over that. There was nothing we could do to change those things in our own strength, short of kneeling at a cross, finding an altar, and turning it over to the only one who can move the unmovable, who can break the unbreakable. There was a time in your life and my life where sin had a hold of us, right? And there was nothing that we could do. Now, we were all bound by different things. You may think, well, I wasn't bound. I didn't have an addiction in my life. We all had an addiction in our lives of some kind, of some shape, in some form. We were all bound by an addiction. Some were bound to alcohol. Some were bound to drugs. Some were bound to other things. But all of us were bound to a disobedience to God, because we all wanted, and still do, if we're not careful, we want to do our own thing. And that's the struggle that you and I have. That's the struggle that Paul talks about in Romans chapter 7. When the things that we want to do, we don't do, and the things that we don't want to do are the things that we end up doing, right? That's the struggle that we all have. That's the struggle that we dealt with. But, aren't you glad for the but? Come on now. Aren't you glad for the but? But God, right? But God aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that the story didn't end with you living in that state? But God. Right? When we read through the Gospels, we read of blind Bartimaeus sitting by the side of the road. who would be there all of his life, but Jesus happened by. Come on now. It's okay. I know that we're supposed to be somber. We're heading to the table of the Lord, but understand what we're about to celebrate here. Right? Lazarus had been dead, buried, laid in the tomb for 4 days. He would have still been in there, but Jesus happened by. Come on. Right? There were 5,000 men and women, plus women and children, that had sat all day long listening to Jesus. Jesus, their disciples came and said, man, the people are hungry, Jesus, right? There are a few loaves and a few fish with a crowd of 20, 25,000 people. But Jesus blessed the bread and the fish, right? So when we say, but Jesus or but God, every single time something happened, something changed. Lives were transformed. The unmovable was moved. The unbreakable was broken. And it happened in your life, and it happened in mine. Whether it was last week, last month, last year, last decade, last millennium, whenever you knelt at that altar and asked Jesus to forgive you of your sin and ask him into your life to be your Lord and Savior, everything changed. And it's that we celebrate and we remember today. Let's bow our heads. Father, as we take this today, we're reminded of your love for us. Jesus, thank you for laying down your life that we might have life. And we thank you for that abundant life today. And the church said amen. The body of Christ that was nailed to the cross, so that the unmovable in your life would be moved. As we take it today, let's rejoice as we remember his sacrifice for us. Thank you, Jesus. The blood of Christ that was poured out like a drink offering, poured out so that our sin was just not covered over, not so that God just looked the other way, but so that the unmovable in your life, the unshakable in your life, was moved and was shaken and was broken by the power of the blood of Jesus. As we take this today, we rejoice that old things have passed away and all things have become new. Let us take together. Jesus, thank you. Thank you that we are not who we used to be. God, we rejoice that old things have passed away and all things have become new. We rejoice that we've been translated out of the kingdom of darkness and into the kingdom of light. God, we rejoice Lord, that the unmovable has been moved in our lives. And Lord, you've adopted us into your family. Thank you. Jesus, thank you for your love for us. Amen. Amen. Thank you. How many know what today is? Pentecost. Pentecost. Now we're going to talk about Pentecost today. And I know I say this on a frequent basis. I say this on a frequent basis, but understand, I'm going to tell you something today that I guarantee you, you don't know. I'm going to guarantee that you're going to hear something today. You're going to hear about Pentecost today in a way you've never heard it. How's that? Is that okay? Now, I know that's setting the bar very high. I do realize that. Because some of you are like me. You were born and raised, and you've been in this all of your life. And we think that we know. And we know a lot. I'm not saying we don't. But I'm going to show you something new today. How many want something new? All right? I'm going to show you something new. All right. Let's talk about Pentecost. How many think they know what Pentecost is? Now everybody's afraid to raise your hand, right? Because I told you I'm going to show you something new. Well, I thought I knew what it was. But we know what it is generally, all right? How many know that the word Pentecost does not appear in the Old Testament? Did anybody know that? There's a couple that know that. All right. We just assume that it did. It was not. Pentecost is actually, it comes from the Greek word Pentecoste, which literally means 50th, all right? And it comes from the fact that it was at the end, it was 50 days after the Passover celebration, all right? So remember that from the time of Passover until Jesus ascends is 40 days, and then he instructs them, go and wait in Jerusalem, and they're there for 10 days. And then when the day of Pentecost comes, and we'll read that verse in a moment, then Holy Spirit comes, mighty rushing wind, fills the house. We know that part of it. But let's look at Pentecost in the roots of Pentecost. Because remember when I said a few weeks ago that when Jesus was born, Bethlehem was teeming with people. Everybody remember that? You know, God brought the people together because from the census, and God brought people together so that they heard of the birth, and those people, they went back, right, with the expectation that HaMashiach has shown up. Everybody go like this, all right? I'm forcing you to do what you're supposed to do, go like that. All right, so they went back with that. Now, remember when we talked a few weeks ago when we talked about the road to Emmaus, when we were talking about our journey with Jesus, remember that Cleopas looks at Jesus and says, where have you been? Right? Why? Because Jerusalem was filled because there were three festivals, remember, where people came, where every male was required to come to Jerusalem. All right. And we're going to read that passage right here. Here it is. In Exodus chapter 23. Exodus 23, verse 14, or beginning with verse 14, 14 through 17, says this, three times in the year you shall keep a feast to me. You shall keep the feast of unleavened bread. Now, unleavened bread was a seven-day feast. It starts with Passover, and there are 7 days after that, right? So it's a total of 8 days. So you had Passover, and then you had the Sabbath that's right after Passover, which is when they took Jesus down off the cross and they put him in the tomb, all right, because Sabbath was coming, right? All right, there were two high holy days back to back, Passover and then the Sabbath, which was the first day of the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So you shall keep the Feast of Unleavened Bread. As I have commanded you, you shall eat unleavened bread for 7 days at the appointed time in the month of Abib, for it For in it you came out of Egypt. None shall appear before me empty-handed. We'll leave that for another time. Verse 16. You shall keep the feast of harvest of the first fruits of your labor, of what you sow in the field. You shall keep the feast of ingathering at the end of the year, when you gather in from the field the fruit of your labor. Three times in the year shall all your males appear before God. All right, go back to verse 16 for just a minute, Stephen, just so we can keep it up there. So there's two feasts that are here. All right, the Feast of Harvest and the Feast of Ingathering. The Feast of Ingathering we would know as the Feast of Tabernacles or the Feast of Booths. All right, it is after the latter rain and the final harvest of the season comes. All right, so that was the latter. That's the Feast of Harvest or the Feast of Ingathering. The Feast of Harvest was the first harvest of the year. It was the barley harvest, typically. And look at that word. First fruits. Now, what do we know about first fruits? What do you know about first fruits? Say it out loud like you're proud of your answer. They belong to the Lord, right? First fruits. We've talked about first fruits a lot. We've talked about first fruits belong to the Lord, right? Right? So I didn't write all those verses down because we've gone over them several times. So you should have them somewhere in your notes. All right. Remember, the first male animal that came along was holy unto the Lord, right? Remember that? We talked about the donkey and unclean had to be redeemed or destroyed. We talked about all that and our salvation, how that's a picture of our salvation, where you and I were unclean and we were doomed for destruction or redemption. There's no other choice, right? All right. So. And the first fruits belong to the Lord. First fruits belong to the Lord. The feast of Pentecost is about first fruits. Let that sink in. It's about first fruits. What we know, they belong to the Lord. First fruits are to be dedicated to the Lord, right? Consecrated to the Lord. Pentecost. Bottom line, in all the things in Pentecostalism, we assign a lot of other things to Pentecost and to Pentecostalism. You know, the indwelling and tongues and interpretation and all the gifts and the fruits and all of those things. Bottom line, Pentecost, and to be Pentecostal is about being devoted to God. It's about being dedicated. It's about being committed to God. Not just at a surface level. All right? Holy, devoted, dedicated. Actually, beyond committed. Now, I know we use those terms interchangeably. You know what the difference between committed and devoted is? A chicken is committed to serving the farmer. Every day, the chicken pumps out an egg. Boom, boom, right? Serving the farmer. Chicken is committed. Chicken is committed. The pig is devoted. Because to serve the farmer, the pig will lay down his life so the farmer can have bacon. Woo! Come on, somebody. Bacon. Right? Pentecost is about being devoted, fully given. Remember, when first fruits are given, they're given to the Lord. You don't take them back. The first fruits weren't, it wasn't an offering. There were several offerings in the Old Testament where they would appear before the Lord. They were given to the Lord, but a portion would go back, a portion would go to the priest, or a portion would come back to the person that was giving. The first fruit was not that way. The first fruit was given wholly, totally to the Lord. Remember, Jericho was a first fruit city. It was totally devoted to God. Everything was given to God. No spoils were to be taken, right? And we know the whole problem with Achan. We've talked about that in the past. You got just a minute for a, let me tell you about Jericho for just a minute. You got a few minutes? Okay, all right. Let me take one of the few minutes you got. I was reading about Jericho the other day, some information and some of the archaeological finds and the digs and all the stuff that was done. There was in the early 19th century, there were several excavations of Jericho, and what they found, I won't even talk about the walls. We'll talk about that sometime. It's amazing what they found. But what they found inside the city was the storehouses were full of grain. Full of grain. Now, that applies a couple of things. One, there was no long siege of the city, right? Because we know there wasn't a siege because what the Word of God says, they marched around and the walls fell down and they walked in, right? And the walls fell in a way. I'm not going to go there. Made little ramps for them. It's cool. It's really cool. All right. But they didn't take anything. So vessels of gold are found there. Vessels of silver are found there. They're buried all under there because all the stuff was devoted to God. It was a first fruits. They didn't take anything. So you and I, if we are fully Pentecostal, we are ready to give our all to God. That's what it's about. That's really what it's about. We don't do that so we can experience Holy Spirit. We don't do that so we can experience gifts of operating in our lives or the fruit of Spirit operating in our lives. We do it out of our devotion to Him. Everything else flows from that, but that's not why we do it. Did you hear me? It's not why we do it. Our motivation isn't so we can get happy and dance or run around the building or any of those kind of things. It's not about that. Now, you guys know me well enough. Hey, when the Spirit of God moves, I'm okay with that. We'll steward the Spirit of God moving. We'll steward that. Nothing wrong with that. But that's not what it's about. That's not what the focus is. When the focus is on that, we lose sight. We lose sight. It's about our relationship with God. First and foremost, it's about our relationship with Him. Being devoted. Being devoted. Found in this first fruit passage. Because this is where it comes from. All right? Here's something else. Now, how many knew that part? Did you know it was about first fruits? All right, some of you knew it was about first fruits. Okay, how about this? We believe that when the law was given on Mount Sinai, we believe that Moses received it in the midst of the festival of harvest, or Pentecost. How many knew that? Anybody? No. Okay. This is cool. Think about this. On the day, on the festival, when God gave the law to Moses, you recall the passage that says that I will write my law on their heart? Guess what happened 2,000 years ago in the upper room, all right? As we move from one plan of God, from the law, and as mercy came and dwelt among us, right? As the Word of God was made flesh and dwelt among us and made a way of transition from the law into grace, on the same day, the same festival that God gave man the law outwardly, He came to put His Spirit on the inside to lead us and to guide us and to direct us. Am I the only one excited about that? Yeah. See, that's what this is all about. That's what this is all about. It's about being devoted. It's about being devoted to God and having His presence on the inside. in a way that is beyond. How many think Moses was a great man of God, right? How many think Elijah was a great man of God? How many think that Elisha was a great man of God, right? Can I keep going? Isaiah, you know, David, Daniel, right? You understand that their relationship with God was very different than your and my relationship with God. They did not have the presence of God living on the inside. Living on the inside, right? They didn't have the presence of God living on the inside like you and I have. And they still accomplish great and mighty things, right? So if they didn't have the presence of God living on the inside of them the way you and I had the presence of God living on the inside of us, and they did what they did, what can we do? Now see, that's why Paul says, now unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all. So if we walk in the presence of God, see. All right, let me move on. Acts chapter 2. You knew we would eventually get there, right? Acts chapter 2, when the day of Pentecost arrived, they were all together in one place. And suddenly, say suddenly. Now say it. And suddenly there came from heaven a sound like a mighty rushing wind. And it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And divided tongues as of fire appeared to them and rested on each of them. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues as the Spirit gave them utterance. I know, we get all excited about that, right? And we should be. There's nothing wrong with that. There's nothing wrong with that. But understand what's happening. It wasn't seeking the experience versus seeking the relationship with God. As you and I, as we press in and seek the relationship with God and desire to be in His presence, everything else begins to fall into place. Everything else begins to fall into place. All right? Now we're going to talk about baptism in a moment. All right. All right. And I know this isn't exactly what we've used to hearing. But it's about relationship. When you and I focus on our relationship with God, and that becomes first and foremost important in our lives. And when that becomes that first fruit where we want to lay it all down for Him, when we want that to be the important part of our life, when we want to give it all to God, God honors that. God honors that. Let's talk about first fruits, but let's real quickly, this should go really fast because we've talked about it a whole lot, right? The whole thing about tithing, right, in Malachi, right? Bring your tithe, your first fruit, into the house, right? Prove me now who worth to see if I won't pour out a blessing, and I will rebuke the destroyer, or rebuke the devourer, right? And we've talked at length about, we've talked at length about the 10% and the 90%, and 90% becomes greater than 100% when the 10% is given to God. We know all of that, right? Right? Some of you are not for sure. Try it. God said, prove me. All right? God said, prove me. Those are God's words. Those aren't my words. Those are God's words. He said, literally the Hebrew says, put me to the test. Test me. Test me. So those of us who've done it, you know what God can do. Amen? You know what God can do. You know what God can do with 90%. God's math is different than our math, right? Now unto him who is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that I, right? I can't even imagine how 90% is greater than 100%, but God can. But God. So that same principle applies in your life and my life. When we lay down our life as a first fruit to God, guess what? God blesses the rest of it. Did you catch that? God blesses the rest of us. So what does he bless? He blesses it with his presence, right? He blesses it with his presence. So just financially, as he blesses it with his presence, he blesses your life and my life with his presence if we lay down our life, if we give that first fruit. So that's the thing. If we focus on that part of Pentecost, if we focus on giving our life to him in dedication, then guess what? The rest is going to happen. The rest is going to happen. God is going to show up. See, this is really what happened in the upper room. When they went and they waited, they 10 days, look what they've done, 10 days, right? From the ascension until Pentecost, those 10 days, they had gathered in the upper room. They weren't doing anything else. They had set aside their entire life to press into God's presence. And God honored that. Did you hear me? Does that make sense? See, that's what it's about when you and I, it's not hard, it's not difficult, it's not, we seek relationship with God. So when we pour into his, when we press into his presence is going to show up. And then when God shows up, then things begin to happen, right? Things begin to happen. All right, that's when all the things that we associate with Pentecost and Pentecostalism, that's when those things begin to happen. When we press in with our relationship with God, the presence of God shows up. That's when. Tongues and interpretation and wisdom and knowledge, all right, and love and joy and peace and long-suffering and gentleness and goodness and meekness and faith, right? Self-control, all when the gifts and the fruits show up, when we press into the presence of God. Because if you and I aren't in the presence of God, then the Spirit of God can't move in our life. Do I need to say that again? If we're not in the presence of God, if we don't press in the presence of God, in the presence of God, then the Spirit of God can't move in our life, right? Does that make sense? So we got to be in the presence of God. Okay, let me look at this verse. Mark. This appears in a couple different places. I chose Mark's version of this. Verses 7 and 8. These are the words of John the Baptist when he is looking forward. The people have come to him, hey, are you the Messiah? Are you the one we're waiting for? And he said, no, I'm not the one. There's one coming after me. Mark chapter 1, begin with verse 7. And he preached, saying, after me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. Oh, you got the whole verse up there, don't you? I just got the first line. I have baptized you with water, that's John, but he will baptize you. But he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. And some of the other Gospels will say with Holy Spirit and fire. All right. John, look at the Word of God here. It's explicitly telling us something. And sometimes we just kind of, we run right past this. I'm going to baptize you with water. He's going to baptize you with fire, all right? With the Holy Spirit. He, Jesus, you know Jesus is the baptizer? It says right there, right? Jesus is the one who does it. What do we know about baptism? What happens with baptism? Baptism is about, it means to immerse, right? Baptizo, we've been here before as well. Baptizo, it means to immerse, right? Everybody remember that? All right, I don't have to stay there, right? So we can move on. So you're put into the water, right? Out of the water, immersed, immersed. So if we're baptized, if we're immersed into the water, if Jesus baptizes us in the Holy Spirit, into the Spirit of God, same word John uses, right? So we are immersed into the Spirit. Immersed. What do we know about immersion, right? Well, when we were baptized, when we were placed under the water totally surrounded us, right? If you opened your eyes, all you could see was the water, right? Couldn't hear anything, right? Everybody know? Couldn't breathe air anymore. If you breathed, what were you breathing? Oh, come on now. Right there, man. Come on, right? Somebody should help me preach right there. Come on. So if we are baptized into Holy Spirit, come on. What should you be breathing? What should we be hearing? What should we be seeing? Come on, somebody. Right? That's what it's all about. That's what it's about. Remember that old Vineyard song? This is the air I breathe. Was that a Vineyard song? That was a Vineyard, wasn't it? This is the air I breathe. Remember that song? Right? Your holy presence living in me. Come on. We've been singing about it. That's what it's really all about. It's about relationship. Everything else flows out of that. Everything else flows out of that. So when you and I press into that relationship, when we decide, God, I need more. This is not enough. Right? I need more. I need you more. Another song, right? When you and I get to that point and the Spirit of God surrounds us, right? When we lay down our life as a first fruit, then God, because He honors that, right? God honors the giving of the first fruit. God blesses what's left. How many want a blessing on your life? On your life, right? We want a blessing on our life. Well, we've got to do some things to get that blessing on our life. We have to do some things, all right? And I'm not talking about, I'm going to set aside all the finance and material. I'm not talking about that tithe. I'm talking about just on our life, on what you and I do. So if we want to be blessed, we have to be in a position to be blessed. Do I need to say that again? You know, God just doesn't bless anything. Can I say that again? I'm going really slow today. I just feel, I'm not doing this intentionally. I'm feeling it. Holy Spirit is pulling the reins back. So I let this just sink in. To receive a blessing from God, we have to be in a position to receive that blessing from God. We have to be in a blessable position. Because God just doesn't bless anything. Right? You know, God doesn't bless evil. That's a good place to say amen, right? God doesn't bless evil. Right? God doesn't bless sin. God doesn't bless disobedience. God doesn't bless chaos. God doesn't bless those things. And if we allow those things into our life, maybe that's why the blessings of God have been choked off in your life. See, that's why we have to continually ask God. Remember that? Search me, O God, right? Psalm 51, search me, O God. See if there be any wicked way in me. And the enemy wants to come along and sit up on our shoulder. Well, bless God, you're okay. Don't worry about it. You asked Jesus into your life 37 and a half years ago. Everything's okay. 37 and a half years is a long time. And everything may have been okay up until yesterday. Right? We may have cracked the door and have allowed something beginning to seep into our life, allow an attitude, allow something in our heart. Right? That is thwarting. I didn't say it severed it, but it's not allowing us to grow. It's choking out. Remember when the Word of God was sown among the weeds? The Word of God came up, but then the weeds came up. See, that's what happens in our lives. Those things begin to happen. Those things begin to grow, and it begins to choke off not just the Word of God in our life. That's important. But when that begins to happen and the Word of God is choked off in our life, then the presence of God in our life begins to be choked off as well. So we've got to stay in a place where God can bless us. All right. And one of the best ways to do that is to be that first fruit, to lay down that our life, press into God, press into His presence so He can bless us with His presence. So He can bless the 90%, as it were. Then once that happens, then guess what? God's going to show up. God's going to show up. Remember that mighty wind it talked about? Wind, right? Now, I know this is in the Greek, but remember, we're dealing with Jews that are up in the upper room, right? So when they would think of wind, what word is wind? Ruach, somebody said it. Ruach. Hey, all right. Good for you, man. All right, man. All right. Ruach, which means wind. It means breath. It means spirit. R-U-A-C-H, Ruach in the Hebrew. Wind, breath, spirit, used interchangeably. So when the wind came in, all right, God breathed upon them, as it were. The Spirit of God entered the room. And transformation takes place. Transformation takes place. See, that bottom line, that's what our relationship with God is all about. Transformation taking place. Where you and I aren't who we used to be. We just celebrated that, right? Had bread and a cup in our hand. We're not who we used to be. Old things have passed away. All things have become new, right? Translated out of the kingdom of darkness, into the kingdom of light. All those. So it's about pressing in. Holy Spirit showed up. Tongues of fire. We sang about that earlier, right? Tongues of fire. Now, they saw it in those days. We think, they saw it in those days. I believe that if God would pull back the veil, pull back the curtain between in our dimension that we're in the spirit dimension, if we could still see, if we could see one another, but we could also see the spirit world around us at the same time, I believe that resting on you, those of you who have pressed in to God in your relationship, as Reinhard Bonnke used to do, right? I believe we'd see that presence resting on. So you and I, we already sense it. We already sense, right? You've been around somebody, you can just feel the presence of God on their life. You know there's an anointing that rests on their life, you know? Whether they don't have to be singing or talking or any of those things. You could just be talking with them. I've met people. I've just passed by people and can feel the presence of God. Some of you are shaking your head. You know, that's what rests on them. That's what this is all about. God wants to do the same thing in your life. It's not just for certain people. It's not just for certain occupations. It's not just for men. It's not just for women. It's not just for whoever stands up here on the platform. It's not just for those who carry a credential. It's not just for those who have Bible school degrees. Because later, Peter, after he stands up in chapter 2, he's going to quote Joel that says, this is what Joel prophesied about. Right? They will pour out on your sons and your daughters, everyone, and your handmaids. All right. All levels of society, all races. Hello? Red and yellow, black and white. Right? No matter what country you're from, no matter where, no matter what your socioeconomic status is, none of that's the prerequisite for it. It's all about our relationship with God and pressing in. And pressing in. And God wants to do it in your life. He wants to do something beyond what He's done in your life. This goes for all of you. All right, some of you sitting there thinking, yeah, I already, you know, yeah. You got that spirit of Apostle Paul. I speak in tongues more than all of you. Nah. It's about an ongoing filling that takes place. It's about an ongoing filling that takes place. You know, see, in Pentecostalism, we talk about too often, hear me, too often we talk about a singular experience, and we talk about it, and we check the box, and we move on. That's why I've taken the direction I've taken today. It's not about the singular experience. It's about the relationship. If we have the relationship, the experience is going to take care of itself. But if we focus on the experience and not the relationship, it's the same as focus upon the gift and not the giver. And if our relationship with God is not strong, when difficult times come, it's easy to question our experience. If our focus is on that versus on what we believe, if our focus is upon what we have experienced versus our faith, knowing what God has done in our lives, knowing that our relationship is where it needs to be with God, because there's going to come days when you don't feel anything. There come days when you and I don't feel, right? We prayed about it earlier. You don't have to raise your hand, but how many times, and you know the presence, how many times has that valley been so deep and so dark? And you felt that you were alone, you wandered. You knew, right? It's faith, right? We walk by faith and not by experience, sight. What we experience. You understand? I'm not discounting that. You guys know I'm not discounting this. Can I take just a few more minutes? I was wanting to be done right now. But we need to hear this. And we're going to pray. We've got to have that firm foundation and that relationship. Because if it's the focus on the feel good, if it's a focus on the spiritual goosebumps, it's a focus on those things. And again, you guys know me. I'm not downplaying that. But that's not where the focus is. The focus is upon relationship. Upon relationship. I told you some of my story last week. You know what? When I'm walking through those days, I didn't feel good. You've had times when you haven't felt good, but you know in whom you have believed, and you are still persuaded that He is able. Amen? So we focus on the relationship and we allow God's presence to come and wrap His arms around us. We focus on that relationship, on that baptism part. Here's where we're going to end. On that baptism part where we're surrounded by his presence. All right, think about jumping in a pool. Some of you, or think about when you were baptized. It's a quick experience, right? It's down and back. It's very quick. But if you can focus on just being underwater, think about that. Think about being underwater in that moment of baptism where we are surrounded. We are surrounded. We open our eyes, we see water, right? What are we hearing? We're just hearing the water. Can't hear anything. Everything else, no matter what else is going on, right? People could have been singing on the riverbank if you were, you know, then, or standing by the swimming pool if that's where you were, or in here if it was in, if you were in a baptistry, wherever that experience you were, they may have been praying, they may have been praising, they may have been shouting, but when you were in the water, you heard none of it. You are lost, or the world around you was lost, right, to your surroundings. That's where you and I seek to remain in his presence, so that all we hear is Holy Spirit, right? Baptized, he will immerse you. This is what John is literally saying. Baptizo, this is literally what he's saying. I am going to immerse you in water, but he is going to immerse you in the Holy Spirit. That's what it's about. It's about being surrounded by his Spirit. It's about all we hear is his Spirit. All we see is his Spirit. And if you breathed underwater, right, all we're breathing in is his Spirit. That's the place that we seek to stay and seek to be. Here's how we're going to end today. If you are ready, or if you want to give your life as a first fruit to God, if you I don't even know how to put this in words. If you're ready to take that step of devotion, not saying that you haven't already, but as just an outward sign of committal or recommittal, of dedication, of rededication, of devotion or redevotion for that matter, of saying, God, I want to give you my all. I want to be immersed in your presence, in your Spirit. I can't, as a show of, I can't do this on my own, and I need you. I'm going to ask you to come and just stand along the front today, and we're just going to pray, all right? Yeah, just begin to come. I'm not going to, that's all I'm going to do. If you want to come for whatever reason, if you have other reasons that are going on in your life, you need a healing or something, come as well. But here is the, and here's what I want you to come expecting. I know some of you are already up here. This may change your mind. No. I want you to come expecting that God's just going to show up however he wants to show up in your life. All right? God is able to do whatever he wants to do right now. All right? Because we're all in a different place in our journey. But it's a matter of committing ourselves committing ourselves to that relationship that goes beyond just a standard relationship, goes beyond just a Sunday morning experience, goes beyond just that going through the motions experience, but that we want to be totally surrounded, immersed in his presence. If you're at home watching the same kind of thing, watching live or watching recorded, I believe that the presence of God is able to walk in into your room right now, whether it's right now, this moment at 11:12, on Sunday or whether it's Thursday afternoon, you're watching this, I believe that the presence of God is able to do that. As I pray, I want you just to lay it all down. However you feel led to lay, whatever drew you up here, give it to the Lord right now, all right? Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, God, I just thank you, God, Lord, that we can come boldly before the throne. Father, we stand in your presence, God, admitting, Father, that, Lord, we can do nothing. But, Father, we just lay our lives on the altar, Father. And, God, as God, as your word says that John said that he would immerse in water. Jesus, John said that you would immerse us in Holy Spirit. And Father, our prayer today is that you would immerse us in your Spirit. Lord, that you would surround us with your Spirit, God. Lord, that you would, even now, God, that your presence would walk into to our lives and that transformation would begin. That some for transformation would just be complete because you've already started transformation in all of our lives at some level, God. But God, I pray that beginning today, Father, a new awareness of your presence would come into our lives. Lord, that we would begin to sense you as never before, God. That we would begin to hear your voice as you lead us and guide us and direct us. That we would hear your presence, hear your voice as we read your word. Lord, as we sit quietly in your presence, Lord, as we meditate, Father, that we would hear your voice. God, that as we sit in your presence, Lord, worshiping you, Lord, that we would sense your presence. Father, I pray that a new awareness would come upon us, God. Lord, we stand, Father, already as your children. And God, I pray that your presence, your Spirit, Lord, would Lord, would touch us, would fall on us, fill us, God, to overflowing. Something fresh, Lord, and something new in all of our lives. Lord, in this quietness right now, Lord, I sense your presence walking among us. And Lord, Father, Lord, we surrender to you. We yield our lives to you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Take just a moment. And just lay your life down at the altar. Just surrender to him. I believe that now things are coming to your mind, areas that you've been slow to give over to God, things that are happening in your life that you think you've got it under control, but God is gently saying, let me have it. Let me show you. Let me help you. Lay those things down. Lay those things down. Those doubts that come in where you wonder, God, am I really walking the right way? Is this really the direction that you're giving me? Is this the direction that you're leading me? Just lay those doubts down in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, God, I ask for clarity. I speak clarity over our minds right now, God. Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Glory. Hallelujah. Lord, I pray that you would stir up the fire of your Spirit within us, God. Lord, that as fire consumes, Lord, I pray, Lord, that it would consume us, Father. Lord, that it would burn out the things that don't need to be in our lives. Holy Spirit, just reveal those things to us. Bring them to our mind, even now. Those things that we need to act upon, those things that we need to set apart, those things that we need to ask for forgiveness, Lord. Those things, Lord, that are holding us back. God, Jesus, help us. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Take just a moment and just thank God. Thank God for what he's doing in your life. Thanks for what he's done in your life. Some of you have already received an answer. You've already felt something's happening. Thank God for whatever's going on right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you right now, Father. We thank you, God, for all that you have done. For what you are doing. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. 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 Father, I pray, God, that Lord, I thank you for your Spirit being poured out, God. Lord, I know there's a revival that's taking place in Kaiser even as we speak, God, and lives are being transformed, God, that healings have taken place, Lord, in dozens, Lord. 50, 60 people have come just in the last 2 days, Lord, have come to know you. And I thank you, God, for that, God. I just praise you, Lord, and I thank you for new lives that have been transformed, Father. And Lord, I know that it's not just here, Father, that across this nation and around the world, Lord, that lives are being swept into the kingdom of God by the move of your Holy Spirit. And God, I pray, Lord, that we here, as we stand here, Lord, in this building, as those, Lord, who are watching right now, Father, that we, Lord, Lord, may we be obedient in this time of you pouring out your presence and pouring out your Spirit. Lord, may we be instruments of revival. May we be instruments of revival. Father, I pray, Lord, as we leave this altar today, God, I pray that your presence and your anointing would rest upon each and every man and woman that stands here today, God. I pray, Father, that you would put a boldness within them, God, that even now it would begin to well up within them, put a boldness within them to share what you've done in their lives, Lord. God, there are testimonies of deliverance that stand here. There are testimonies of healing that stand here. There's testimonies of forgiveness that stands here. There's testimonies, Lord, of relationships that have been restored that are standing at this altar, Father. I pray that you would give them opportunity to speak their testimony. Give them opportunity to share what you've done in their lives, God. Father, may we be quick, Lord, to testify of your goodness. Of that goodness that has followed us all the days of life. Lord, may we open our mouth and share with the world around us, Father. May we be your missionaries here in this area. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Father, as we leave, may we walk in your presence. May we walk in your peace. May we share your blessing with a lost and dying world. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Shake hands with your neighbor. It's been good to be in the house.